First of all, you're all very welcome here to Community University. For those of you who don't study here already, as usual, welcome and staff as well. And big thanks to Professor Clara Ponsatí for coming over to the new to have this really interesting discussion, and to Professor Peadar Kirby for coming from Cloughjordan Ecovillage today, another professor here in the Department of Sociology as well. So I'm going to hand over to Peadar and Clara now, and they're going to have a discussion around the issue in Catalonia.
So good evening. I've already said to Clara I was intending to be able to welcome her in Catalan. I don't speak Catalan. I was going to get on to a Catalan friend of mine, but I failed to do so. I daren't welcome her in Castilian, so I'll welcome her instead, Osquenga. So Clara Tofolche is better out of Chogaher, so that's called Monulit. So that's a welcome in Gaelic in our native language. Y bienvenida a Irlanda también. Señoras, a ahogarme por hablar castellano. So you are very welcome. I think my role here is really just to prompt Clara to tell us something about herself. I don't see my role here as being to ask the bigger questions, if you like, about the case for independence and the arguments for or against. I'll leave that to you. Shane tells me we have 3/4 of an hour and then it's open to yourselves. I'm presuming there will be people who will ask those sorts of questions. So the first question I'd like to ask Clara is to tell us a little bit about what led her into politics and the role that she played in the government that declared independence, that held the referendum on the 1st of October 2017, and then following that declared independence.
It was a little bit of an accident. You know, I've always been interested politics, and I've always been a committed citizen and supporter of Catalan self-government. But I was somewhat active in politics when I was very, very young, at the end of the Franco regime and the very first years of transition, but then I never had a career in politics. I've had an academic career, but I am a Catalan, I'm a very committed Catalan, and I've been supporting the independence movement. I mean, it's very, in my case, it's hard to set a date, you know, what day did you start supporting independence, in terms, I think, and I think that's, it's the case for many of us, that we always had this dream that our nation deserved to be normal. But we also had this, say, political skepticism that maybe the cause of independence was politically not viable. And it's true that, you know, most of Catalans, and I think I included myself on that set, the main memory of the transition years was that, well, you know, what we're getting is not what we like, but it's better than what we had, so let's give it a go. So, you know, Catalonia got some degree of self-government, but there were misgivings from the very beginning. Because it's clear, you know, everybody who knows a little bit about the transition knows that that wasn't as frosty as it was painted for many years. But, you know, eventually we realized that we were not getting, any degree of self-government, that, you know, that whatever our institutions, whatever power our institutions got was being eroded, that there was a very clear agenda on the part of the Spanish nationalism to keep eroding it and to recover it. So in this sense, I was involved. I was a member of the Catalan National Assembly, which was the organization that was set up, I think, in 2013. Correct me if I'm wrong. With the clear agenda of moving the I had an incident in my academic life in 2013. I was the Príncipe de Asturias Distinguished Professor at Georgetown University. And as such, I was the university, I was contacted by some press through the university, and I had, I was invited to a debate at Al Jazeera. On the days just following the September 11 demonstration of 2013, must have been 2012, which was a huge demonstration in favor of independence. So they invited me to this debate, and I expressed, I was, you know, quite moderate, I would say. I expressed, you know, I tried to be academic in describing why so many people were on the streets, you know, are they crazy, or what are the reasons why Catalans want to be independent, or why, you know, a fraction of Catalans at that time. It wasn't clear how many, but how big that was. So I participated in this debate. I had also participated in some discussions about the tax deficit as a profession. That was a professional involvement, but it was political in the sense that we were saying, hey, the transfers that Catalonia is sending to Spain in taxes are not coming back in appropriate proportions and so on. So I was politically involved. Because of this intervention in the press, I was kicked off from the very distinguished Príncipe de Asturias chair. So I became relatively well known. That was on the news, to my surprise. And I didn't think of me as anybody of any importance, but you know, that made it in the news. So people knew me. And well, it turned out, but you know, I continued my academic life, and I moved to St. Andrews in 2015 to take a chair there. And well, the summer of 2017, Mr. Puigdemont was reshuffling his cabinet. He had set September for the time of the self-determination referendum. And he was having problems in his cabinet getting sufficient support. Some of the people were, at that point, decided that they didn't want to remain in government for all kinds of reasons. So they were looking for people. And for one of these, you know, coincidences, I knew one of the people that were in the meeting on the day that they were trying desperately to find someone to be the education minister. My name came up. And they called me, and I was in Barcelona. It was very late at night. I had had a very nice dinner with a number of friends, with good food and good wine. And they called me, and it was a total shock. They were, of course, when they do these things, politicians, now I've learned a little bit, but at that time I didn't know. They are in a total hurry, you know, they call you at midnight, and you need to tell them yes or no. You know, by a.m. in the morning. So you know, it seemed like an interesting challenge. And I consulted my son, who was also coming from dinner with some friends. And, you know, he said, of course, Mom, why don't you say no? So here I am. I just, you know, I accepted the challenge. Do I regret it? You haven't asked, but I can volunteer the answer. It depends on the day. It depends on the reasons. I feel very proud of what we did as a government, up until October 2017. I'm part of that. Certainly, I'm paying a very rare price, because as you probably know, but in case you don't, since November 2017, the government that organized the referendum is either in prison or in exile. So at this point, I am a free citizen of the world, except in the Kingdom of Spain, which means that I cannot go home. You know, I cannot. I've seen my family, but they have to come and see me. I cannot. You know, I cannot go to my place in Barcelona. So it's, you know, it's an odd. It's very odd that, you know, the 21st century Western Europe, and there is people in exile, and there is people in prison, which is certainly much worse.
I was going to come back, because that's a little bit at the end. I thought it would be interesting for us to hear about the internal debate. So you joined the government as an independent, not a member of any of the...
Well, I joined as an independent. I remained an independent. Yeah. But I was sort of appointed on the share of the PDeCAT. The government was a coalition government of Esquerra and PDeCAT, and I was appointed on the PDeCAT slot, so to speak. So the people that called me were people in PDeCAT.
And so you participated actively in the final discussions, which decided on going ahead with the referendum and then declaring an independent Catalonia. Can you tell us something about those discussions?
No. I'm not supposed to disclose those discussions.
Well, I appreciate the detail of them, but you can...
Okay, so let's see. I can give you a flavor. Okay, for the first few weeks, I didn't participate very much in the discussions. In fact, as far as I observed, I had the impression that there weren't any discussions. There was a plan. And it seemed that the plan was progressing as established. So from my point of view, my assignment in the plan was not that major. The schools have to be available, but that's not such a big deal. Yes, I did a bit of planning to make sure that, you know, that the keys were in the box. That contact persons in every place were available and willing, because we were not going to force anybody to do that. But apart from that, there was not much of a discussion, as far as I know. If I can be a bit candid, maybe I should have been surprised, or I should have wondered at the time that there was no more discussion about, well, what are we going to do next, how are we going to do this, how are we going to do that. Certainly, you know, the plan was quite bold, we're going to have a referendum, and if the answer to the referendum is yes, we're going to be independent. Well,
but that under Spanish law was illegal.
That's very debatable. That's, you know, this is a constitutional discussion. We don't agree with that. We had a majority a government that had a mandate, and you know, that government had run on a platform for independence. It was very explicit. That government had won that election. It had a majority of parliament with the support of the coup. You know, there is a discussion which is still open, and repression and all kinds of things, but it's a big discussion whether the Catalan Parliament is sovereign or is not. I firmly believe that the Catalan Parliament is sovereign. I firmly believe, and Spain has included that in its constitution, in the self-determination right of the people. So, of course, I mean, that's debatable. The problem with this debate is that Spain has taken a a non-political approach to that debate, and rather than having a discussion and having a negotiation or seeking help in that this negotiation is difficult, because it certainly is, rather than doing that, Spain has just taken the approach that this is illegal, therefore it is criminal, which is one more step. I mean, I challenge the claim that it is illegal. The claim that it is criminal, it's not that I challenge. Everywhere in Europe, except in say, challenging. So the discussion about constitutional issues, do we have a right to have a referendum or not, how should we proceed after we have a referendum, this is, this is a discussion to have. The discussion about if you do it, then you're criminal, that is not a discussion within, that is not a democratic discussion.
So take us through then the day of the vote, and we all know about the actions of certain police that were brought in from other parts of Spain, and then rather to the outsider, chaotic declaration of independence afterwards. In fact, certainly it wasn't to me absolutely clear that independence had been declared. How did that seem to you as somebody in a very senior position with a responsibility?
Yeah,
for
so you're not asking me about the day of the referendum, you're asking me about the days after.
I'm asking you to describe the days, I'm asking you about both. So you lived through that with a responsibility for it, and as education minister, of course, much of the voting took place in schools, so that involved to a certain extent, and then just the following days.
Okay, on the day of the referendum, I recommend everybody who hasn't seen, the images to go and watch them. Mm-hmm. There is several documentaries, there is a web page that has all kinds of videos and so on, and, the images are so vivid that no word that I can use. It's going to give you the impression of what happened on that day. That was a day in which Catalans decided that they wanted to have a vote, and they had it in spite of, the Spanish state sending 10,000 police to repress them and hit them as much as they could. And the police were sent to terrorize people because they were not sent to go and try to get, the ballot boxes or the ballots or close, precinct buildings. That was not their plan. Their plan was to terrorize people. But they failed. People were terrorized. People were hit, some people were hurt. Fortunately, nobody was fatally hurt. Some people were very badly hurt, but that didn't prevent people from taking the vote, and the vote took place. Participation was very high considering the circumstances. If we compare the participation and the results of that day to the Brexit referendum, the proportion of the Catalan electorate that on that day supported independence is higher than the proportion of the British electorate that supported Brexit. I'm not going to argue about Brexit, so please don't ask me about that. But just, if we think that the result of a referendum is, for example, if we compare to the result of the NATO referendum, which was taken in Spain, and it's, Spain joined NATO as a result of that referendum, participation on that referendum was lower, and so on. Okay, so in these terms, the referendum took place. The result was, a total, very clear. The discussion gets more nuanced and more difficult when we go into what happened afterwards. What happened afterwards was that the leaders of the political parties, Mr. Puigdemont, Mr. Junqueras, and so on, I was a senior member of government, I was the most junior in terms of my influence. Because I was the more outsider, right? I had not been there for the many months since the election. I was not a member of the party. So in this sense, I was an outsider. So what happened afterwards was that, and if we listen at what the people who are now on trail, the way they explain those days, their approximation is, we thought that was going to be a way to negotiate with Spain. And that's a very honest approximation. We're going to have a referendum. Spain will have to sit and negotiate, and Europe is going to take Spain to the table, and you know, they'll have to sit and talk. That was their hope. And I, you know, in retrospect, we realized that everything that had been planned or prepared or discussed was filtered through this idea, you know. Europe will not tolerate, for example, you know, we were convinced or we were saying, you know, the moment we see policemen taking ballot boxes, at that moment we've won, because Europe will not tolerate that. At that moment, you know, Mrs. Merkel is going to take the telephone and take Mr. Ahoy by the ear and he'll have to sit and talk.
But this
didn't happen. Okay, I'm not going to tell you what I believed, because I don't, you know, I don't want to put too much importance on myself. I think this was the belief of the government and of the political elite. Probably it was also combined with a surprise about how strong the turnout was and how brave the Catalans were on October 1st. It was a combination of, you know, surprise at the behavior of the Catalan people and surprise at the behavior of the European institutions, surprise at the behavior of the Spanish police. It was a combination. Were they naive? Well, I mean, when you do something like that, it's not that you've, you know, had much opportunities to train for it and experiment and, you know,
but the European Union has made its view clear, so.
And they made a view clear that, well, if we see, you know, thousands of COVID hitting your people, we're just going to go the other way. We're talking that. They had not made it view clear. They did it. They just looked the other way. You know, I mean, that was happening at their door, you know, and they just ignored it. Had the same thing, or, you know, a tenth of that thing happened in somewhere in the East or in Latin America, they would have reacted with outrage. So at this point, well, we've learned the lesson. I hope we have learned the lesson.
But if you saw it as a moment, as an action, if you saw the referendum as an action that would open negotiations with the central government in Spain, the swift declaration of independence immediately afterwards didn't give a space for that.
It didn't? I mean, there was not a swift declaration of independence.
It was in a day or two, if my memory is right. How long was it afterwards?
No. That's what I thought we should have done. But no. The referendum was October 1st, and Puigdemont reported the results of the referendum according to the requirements of the referendum law on October 10th. And then he did that in politics it's hard to know what's on. But you know, he said, well, according to the referendum, Catalonia is independent, but I'm going to suspend that and try to negotiate. That's what he did October 10th. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, he went on into a struggle to try to see if somebody would pay attention to his plea. All kinds of people were, I wasn't there. He has not quite reported yet about what happened on those days. Hoping that sometime he will. He says that, you know, there is people in prison and people that are being on trial, therefore he doesn't want to report. Okay, I respect that. I was not involved whatsoever, so I cannot, you know, even if I wanted, I wouldn't be able to share information with you about that. So that's what happened, and then eventually there was a lot of pressure for him to call an election. He almost accepted that is also well known. In fact, he had prepared the papers to call an election in the hope that Spain was at least going to stop the execution of Article 155. But the people that were mediating, that I think this is a strong, they were mediating, but the people that were talking to both sides couldn't assure that, and so he just let the parliament do the proclamation of independence of October 27. But at that point it was very clear, because the government had you know, many discussions, and the government was totally behind the idea of calling an election. The government was either unable or unwilling to go on with the implication, so it was, as my colleagues that are in Andre and Madrid have declared, that's what they say. I haven't been before a judge, so haven't had the need to explain it before a judge. When they explain it before a judge, I say, well, we didn't do anything. Okay. So is Catalonia independent or not? Well, certainly not. but it's true that there was a law passed by the majority of the parliament that said, well, you know, if we have a referendum and the referendum approves independence, we have the mandate. We know the government has an obligation to take us to independence. That part was not done.
So where does it go now? I mean, do you feel that the attempts by Sanchez, when he took over, have helped in any way to open some sort of a dialogue? From a distance, it appears at least that it's better to have him there than to have Rajoy.
He's more polite.
He has attempted to be somewhat conciliatory.
More handsome as well.
Okay, I'm not going to get into it yet.
But my question is, where do you see it going now? Clearly the trials are raising tensions. But there is a standoff.
Okay. I don't, you know, it's very hard to see how things will move. Basically, they are at a standstill. Rajoy's approach was, okay, we're going to suspend government, we're going to take these people to jail. They gave very precise orders to the judiciary. The judiciary was happy to comply. They created this the narrative of the rebellion and that violence was, you know, it's this the argument is, well, we can accuse these people of rebellion because there was violence, and there was violence because they knew that if they call a referendum, then there would be violence because we would have to have hit. You know, it's our obligation to hit you, and therefore that's a rebellion, which is the most contrived argument you could ever pick up. That's never going to persuade any neutral, impartial judge. But that's, you know, judges in Spain, at least in the Supreme Court in Spain, are not impartial. So they are, you know, happy to perform this service to the unity of Spain, because, you know, they see it as a service to the unity of Spain. They've openly declared, Mr. Lesmes, the president of the Supreme Court, have openly declared that the unity of Spain is one of the founding principles of the Spanish democracy, and it's above anything else. I mean, when you have judges that have this ideological bias, this is ideological bias, and it's a very strong one, well, then anything goes. But certainly anything goes as long as they are in charge. As soon as someone who's independent looks at the facts, the accusation is not sustained, and that's what we have proved in several European courts, and explicitly the court in Schleswig-Holstein had, you know, looked at the fact and said, well, you know, what we saw on those days was demonstrations, expressions, you know, maybe some, you know, incidents, but nothing that amounts to anything criminal. And, you know, they've written that with a transparent clarity, and, you know, the judges in Spain at some point would have to, you know, compare their arguments with those, and if they don't, well, some the European Court of Human Rights certainly is going to be looking at both verdicts. I think I have drifted a little bit.
It's all very interesting. I mean, to just focus attention on
what's
the same there are now a series of elections coming up.
Yes.
So
we have the
national elections,
okay.
European elections,
okay. Yes.
And you have a hardening of the right,
yeah.
With the emergence of Vox, with the way that the campaign is going under its new leader.
Yeah.
This panorama looks to be deepening the divisions rather than moving us anywhere forward.
Rajoy started the repression machine, which we're seeing now in full force, and he could not, you know, there was a motion of confidence that was passed because the Catalan parties decided that they were going to kick Rajoy out and appoint, you know, made Sanchez the prime minister. There was no exchange of any, there was no political deal at all. They just did it because, you know, they did this service of clearing Mr. Rajoy out of the picture, which is certainly service. And then there was some hope, at least, you know, in Europe, you know, in the European press and, you know, in Brussels, there was an expectation that Sanchez was going to try to resolve that. Probably there was some expectation on our side that there was going to be some decisions, at least, some gestures or something. Nothing happened. You know, the prosecutors in Spain make their case at the instance of the government. So one simple thing that could have happened is that, you know, the new prosecutor looks at the fact and says, well, no, this is not a rebellion, this is not sedition. So we're going to indict for lesser charges. That could have happened, but didn't happen. I suspect that it didn't happen because Sanchez doesn't have the power to tell the prosecutors what to do, whereas Rajoy had the capacity to give them ideas, and they, or maybe they gave him ideas. I don't know. It's hard to know where the origin of the creation is. But so the thing is that the prosecutors have maintained their case. That Vox, which is, you were referring to them, Vox, which is the extreme right party, who has been always behind the origin of all the criminal charges, remains as an accusation part. It was very easy. They wanted to say, okay, Vox is out of the trial. They didn't do that. So the trial has moved on as if Rajoy was still the prime minister, and then, you know, possible discussions about how to manage the Catalan crisis. Well, you know, they met and they had some, you know, good meetings, so some good pictures, yeah. Let's put it this way, but he couldn't offer anything. I suspect that, you know, the Socialist Party is very, very much, I mean, it has a I don't know how big it is, but it has a very powerful faction that is extremely Spanish nationalistic, and that just goes along with the same agenda than Rajoy was. So they are not going to give in any way. Some of them might be more open to maybe, you know, look at the trial, you know, see what they can do with after the sentences, but, you know, so far they haven't been able to move. And, you know, they couldn't pass a budget because the position, the Catalan party said, well, okay, we supported your appointment, but now you haven't done anything, so why should we pass your budget? And then he took the opportunity, you know, at that point, he could have stayed. I mean, if he wanted to just stay on, he could have stayed on, even without the budget. But I think he just, you know, know, he had this impression, and he was probably right, you see, in a few weeks, that it was a good moment for him to run an election. And the least that he will get is the control of his party, because, well, I mean, it would be too much to get into the details of how Sánchez got to be the Secretary General of his party, but it was a very involved story as well, and he certainly didn't have in parliament, people of his own speaking, and so what he will get in the next, with the next election, is he will get, he will not have a majority, he will need to, you know, get support to get a majority, but he will have a far, substantially higher share of the seats, and the people that will be sitting on the Congreso will be people of his speaking. So this is what he's gaining. We'll see. And in the meantime, the nationalist, the Spanish nationalist upsurge has generated an amazing competition at the right to see who is the most extreme. And so Ciudadanos and PP have been competing to see who is more fun of bullfighting and more ready to put them on in prison. And then, Vox has appeared as a parliamentary force. Vox was not a parliamentary force. It has appeared as a parliamentary force in Andalusia. And in a way, it's sort of, they could take the government in Andalusia thanks to their votes. They did it. They feel okay about it. And so now, the thing is that the right is divided between three parties. They'll pay that surely, that certainly benefits Sanchez. I very much doubt that I'll have to swallow that. So, okay, I'm gonna go finish my sentence. I very much doubt that the right will have a majority to just control parliament, and certainly they will not have a majority in Senate. So their agenda, which is a long and permanent control of the Catalan government, so suspension, permanent suspension until Catalans realize that this idea of independence, that's not right. Yeah, because that's the only solution they are offering. Just, change your mind because your idea is no good. they're telling that to more than 2 million people that they haven't so much changed their mind, and the more they see repression and the more they see how Spain is behaving, the more convinced they are that there is no other way out than independence. So yeah, I mean, it's still going to be a while before we see things moving in terms of a political resolution of the Catalan-Spanish conflict. Yes, it's going to take a while. And this election is not going to be a breakthrough yet.
So meanwhile, how do you begin healing what is a profoundly divided society?
I don't agree with that. It's true that support for independence might not have a huge majority. We haven't, the data we have is the October 1st referendum and the election after that. So if you don't want to look at the October 1st referendum, that to me is the reference. Mm-hmm. When I think of Clara, do you have an obligation with the Catalans? They say, yes, I do. I have an obligation with what the Catalans said October 1st. But okay, let's consider the election of the December 21st election. The December 21st election left about 48% of the votes were clearly in support of independence. There is always the difficult, it's always difficult to understand in that issue what people that support communes support. Some of them support independence, some of them don't. And then there is people that support the Ciudadanos and PSC and PP that certainly are against, and that's around 40. Okay, this is certainly a politically polarized situation. I wouldn't, can say that this is not conflictual. But, you know, what is not true is that Catalan society is deeply divided and suffering. You know, this is not Northern Ireland. It isn't. You know, I haven't been to Barcelona for a while, but I hear, you know, life is, people are sad, our side is sad, but, you know, life is, you know, smooth as it was. There is no social confrontation. There is no ethnic, I mean, it's very clear that there is no ethnic component whatsoever on the independent side. There has been an attempt on the side of Ciudadanos, but, you know, we're going to see, one of the things we're going to see in the next election is Ciudadanos losing a lot of support in Catalonia. That is clear from the polls. I mean, the polls may be wrong, but they are always, you know, wrong by a smaller fraction than this huge loss. The Socialist Party is gaining, which in a way is good news. Have to be ones, I think that it's different. And that shows that, yes, some people that supported Ciudadanos and supported right after the, if you want to call it, the October independence mess, happy to use that term, because they were upset and they supported Ciudadanos, but now they are not supporting it because the policy, the politics taken, you know, the attitude taken by the leaders of Ciudadanos has been extremely confrontational, extremely, you know, trying to really ignite division and violence, and they have failed at that. You know, they go to places and start, you know, all these battles about the yellow ribbons. They are extremely aggressive, but, you know, they don't get popular support from that. It's always, you know, a few people, and they are all, you know, connected to the TV, and it's, you know, this. So, I don't think we have a problem of civil division.
My last question is going to be the question that you raised at the beginning. I mean, it's not so much regrets, I wouldn't like to phrase it that way, but your own personal situation must be a very difficult one now. You're basically an academic, as I understand, who was drawn rather accidentally into politics. I mean, in terms of your own life, this must be a really difficult period to be living through. And where do you see that going at a personal level?
I mean, yes, it's a difficult situation. I wouldn't recommend it to anyone. But I think it's also a huge opportunity that I have been given by, you know, by this historical accident. That, you know, I think very few people. And in that, I think I'm sure, you know, other people will share the same thing. It's an idea that some Italian friend of mine said, you know, you Catalans are very lucky. Because in a moment in which, you know, everybody just cares about, you know, their own benefit and their, you know, their family, their car, their house, their mortgage, and, you know, in an age of huge individualism, we're living a moment of, you know, huge, you know, collective communion. And I think this is something that very few generations get the opportunity, you know, in each country, and it, you know, each country has its moments, but I think that we are living through an exceptional period. And this feeling that we're participating in something that is big is very important. So when I think about my situation in this context, I think it's, you know, that I've given an extra bonus at this great opportunity, and I can only be grateful.
Clara, thank you very much. I think that was fascinating. what I presume would be questions that focus more on the bigger issues of independence. Obviously, I'm very interested in those also. So I throw it open to the floor.
Right. Has Ponsatí in here? Because you are not allowed to go to Catalonia. Well, thanks for your visit, by the way. The thing is, you're not allowed. You're still accused of rebellion, yeah?
Yeah.
Rebellion.
And sedition. Misappropriation of funds.
Yeah.
Disobedience.
Yeah.
Maybe I
forget. Yeah. And
criminal charges.
Yeah, the thing is, for the people who don't know, maybe rebellion, to be a rebel, what do you got to do to be a rebel?
Well, according to the Spanish penal code, you have to uprise armed. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a violent uprise to subvert the state.
No, the thing is, we obviously see you are a violent person.
The
thing is,
I like the name. You know, like I think it has very positive connotations. In political terms, I think that you know the idea of people rebelling is nice and good. You know, but Catalans are rebelling in a very in absolutely peaceful means. And on the other side, yes.
Yeah, the thing is, I try to imagine what kind of violence did you apply to against Spain, you know, to uprise or something, you know, what kind of weapons, what kind of helicopters, maybe. But the thing is, it seems that it's something that I don't really understand. It seems that the president, Carlos Puigdemont, is not accused anymore of rebellion. It seems the the thing. It seems that the judge. He retired the charge of rebellion.
The German judge said that they were willing to grant his extradition, but only if he was going to be tried for misappropriation of funds, because they couldn't see any grounds for the other accusation. So they were ready to take Mr. Puigdemont and put him in a plane to Madrid or to Barcelona, I don't know, so that he would stand trial. The problem with that was that if Puigdemont could only stand trial for misappropriation of funds, everybody else could only stand trial for misappropriation of funds. And faced with that, the instructor judge, Mr. Llerena, decided that he didn't want Puigdemont on those terms. However, he did not withdraw the Spanish order of arrest and the case. In Spain, if we go to Spain, we would be joining our colleagues at the Tribunal Supremo under the same accusations. We'll see how things change after the trial has finished and there has been a verdict and so on, but for the moment, we have the full back.
So all of you are still...
All of us, I mean, the people who, among the people, the five members of government that are in exile, three of us have the full accusations, the stronger accusations, which this is Mr. Comín, Mr. Puigdemont and myself, and then Ms. Mr. Puig and Ms. Serret, they have accusations of misappropriation of public funds. They have not accusations of
because they weren't ministers.
They were ministers, but they constructed this story that there was violence. And so where was the violence? The violence was in developed places. So who are the ministers that are accused of rebellion? All ministers that were managing buildings that were offered as ballot places are included in the rebellion accusation. Then the president, the vice president, the minister of the presidency, Mr. Turull, who was the referendum organizer, and the minister of infrastructure. In his case, I think the accusation is built along the something that has to do with thoughts. I mean, for my mental sanity, I have very consistently maintained the approach of not going too much into the detail and listening too much to what's going on. I mean, I get briefings and say, well, you know, if I ever have to get through that sort of ordeal, then I'll have to get more attention to detail, but at this point I'm not. But anyway, so the argument is, I provided the schools, Mr. Comain probably provided the, some centers of health. This is Douglas Vassa provided the social center, so these the three places that were buildings and so on. So they, some of people were managed through the Minister of Justice for some reason. If not among those that said, don't try to understand things that they're not interested.
If I can just mention, before I ask my question, I'm a lawyer, and I mean, I think I know about the European arrest warrant. I don't know about the extradition arrangements with Switzerland. There are two women over there.
Yeah.
But I can say that those arrest warrants, European arrest warrant, should have been executed, okay, in the normal course of events. But I think that the reason they weren't was because of those, the police baton charges. I mean, those images went all over the world. And I think that the Spanish government did the greatest favor they ever could to the Catalans by showing what the Spanish government, Spanish people, well, certainly not all, I'm not saying that at all, but showing what the Spanish government thinks of Catalans. And I think, but in retrospect, they did the greatest favor. But what I'd like to ask him is that, it seems to me that most people in Europe think that repression of, say, the Catalan language began in 1939 and ended in 1982 or 1983. But in reality, the repression or marginalization of Catalan started in 1714. And it's considered, and the problem is, it seems to me that the Spanish right leaves Catalonia alone as long as they need their support in the Spanish government, in the Spanish parliament. When they are dependent on votes from Jordi Pujol, or there's a strong Spanish contingent within the Socialist Party, then they leave Catalan alone. But as soon as they get a majority, they go, whether there's something in the Spanish psyche, I don't know why, but they just feel that they have to go against Catalonia, go against Catalan, however you want to see it. And it seems to me the Generalitat did not really explain this well to people, that they think that, as I say, that the repression of Catalan stopped in 1982 or 1977 or whatever, okay?
Are you asking a question or giving a speech?
No, do you agree with that?
Okay. I don't agree with everything you said, but it's hard to. We certainly could explain our cause better. That's beyond doubt. I think that if we want to think positively of what we have achieved in the last couple of years, is that our case is now. No, I know. I go and take a taxi in Cambridge, and they ask you where are you from. I say Catalonia now, and they know. Oh yes, I know you have issues.
So do they.
just keep doing the test. Now I consistently, do the taxi test. It works quite well. So we've become, in Brussels it's trivial, Brussels is fully well informed, of course, but, much more in general, it used to be that you would say, well, I'm Catalan, I say, what? So you had to tell them, yeah, I'm from Barcelona, where Messi is, right? Now you don't need Messi. You don't need Barcelona. Okay, so we certainly are in the international news agenda, which is one step. That was a necessary condition. We still are not quite, you know, into the situation of, oh, we're not a problem to anybody else except us. And that's a step that, you know, until we become a problem to more than just us, it's going to be very hard to unlock this situation. You know, Europe needs to realize, now Europe has realized that this is not an internal Spanish problem. They know that now, they know well that. But they still don't feel that this is their problem. And until we you know, that whatever steps we take, and you know, I'm not going to give advice to all my colleagues, you know, it's a difficult corrective action problem. But whatever steps we take have to be in the direction of persuading other European citizens, public opinions, and leaders that we are their problem.
Yeah, driving the case for Catalan independence forward, I wonder what you feel the level of support among, first of all, other groups within Spain, for instance, the Basques, but also within the European institutions, the European Parliament, groups within Europe itself. What is the level of support? Do you feel that the tide is turning in your favour? Or do you think that the European establishment is more tied towards the Spanish state?
Okay, I think it's the tide may not be quite a tide yet,
yeah.
But there is more and more signals.
Mm-hmm.
There is support in the European Parliament, not a huge one. We'll see what support we get after the next election.
Mm-hmm.
It's important that Puigdemont himself is going to run, and in the European election, I think this is going to, you know, make the case even more visible, because there are going to be all kinds of issues. Is he allowed to take his seat in Parliament? Is Spain will do whatever to prevent it, but it's going to be very hard with Spain, and the discussion is not going to be in the Spanish courts, the discussion
mm-hmm.
is going to be in the European courts.
Yeah.
So it's not going to be Mr. Juncker or
mm-hmm.
Mr. Timmermans
mm-hmm.
deciding, or what's the name of the president of the parliament?
That is
Italian.
Tajani.
It's not going to be up to Mr.
Mm-hmm.
Tajani to decide whether Mr. Puigdemont can take his
seat
in parliament. It's going to be up to the European Court of
European Court of Justice.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So this is turning. France is a very interesting phenomenon. France is our next door neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
There is a part of Catalonia in France. It seemed that they were, you know, not going to budge. They have, you know, they are Jacobins and but, you know, just last week, or not even 1 week ago, 41 French senators signed a letter very explicitly complaining about the situation of the trial and asking for human rights to be respected in Catalonia. You know, it's a very clear letter, and they were asking for France and the European institutions to take action. This has generated a huge outrage in Spain, to the level that the president of the Supreme Court has sent a letter to the president of the French Senate, what about division of powers, huh?
Mm.
Complaining that some senators are expressing opinions. I mean, all these things, okay, is the tide turning? Okay, I mean, I think, you know, we're not there yet, but this is, you know, this is going to be, you know, we need to work this, but I think it's, you know, we're making progress.
Do you feel that you're getting encouragement from the Basque independent movement.
Okay, that's a very interesting question. I think, you know, the Basque society is complex, as all societies. There are some sectors in the Basque nationalism that are very supportive and that see our struggle as a good example, especially these other parts of the Basque nationalism that have realized that that have gone through the process of peace, that have given up violence, people around Arnaldo Otegi. So these people are very supportive. The more establishment nationalists, the PNV, well, they sort of wait and see.
Yeah.
Right? They have a fantastic deal in their charter of self-government. Why should they upset that if they can just sit and wait, see what Catalans can do? And, well, if we work it out, sure enough, they'll think about it.
Yeah. Thank you for your intervention. I was really looking forward to listening to this because I follow this from the beginning. I have to fight with all my family, with many people, with my position, supporting Catalonia, supporting it from a very sort of, you want, it's not physical, but it's from my thoughts about Catalonia. But lately I have been a bit concerned or a bit sad because as we know in Spain, in Europe, there is a huge race of extreme right. These people are really not only against Catalonia or they are against everything that is normal in life. And they are igniting the country really, really much. Up to a point that up to now, I follow politics very closely. I don't know the political agenda of Ciudadanos, Vox, or even the PP at the moment, apart from going against Catalonia. But the problem is that they are actually getting lots and lots of support. So to me, if you don't mind me saying, it was a huge mistake not to support the budget, because if there is only one person who could probably ease the situation a little bit or negotiate slightly, is the current president. So my question is, why did you do that? Because I've been asking,
I wasn't there.
Why did they close the door when there was, in my view, probably not in theirs obviously, it was the only door that I could see, because up now, what's going to happen now if the right, you said that they are not going to, but they are going to, the three of them are going to actually take a lot of votes, and there is a huge amount of emotion there for lots of Spaniards who actually only see Catalonia. They don't see the schools, they don't see education, they don't see health, they don't see anything. The only thing they seem to be concerned about is Catalonia. And they
I
understand your concern. I can see the point, but let's just remind ourselves what the socialists have done. They went full force with the suspension of the Catalan government. They supported it with enthusiasm, right? And so far they've taken no step whatsoever, zero. So do you think it's not a question. I don't think it would be good politics to keep supporting a socialist or whatever government in Madrid just because what may come might be worse. Because if you're not doing anything, if you're doing exactly the same, the fact that you're transformer and you call yourself socialist doesn't make you different from this other, for the alternative, okay? So, in a way, the argument, just be quiet and support Sanchez because otherwise we're gonna have, the right in control in Spain. Well, at this point, I think that we Catalans we need to care more about, you know, our politics. We're not there to resolve the issues of, you know, if there is this huge surge of the extreme right, or if, you know, if the PP has sort of split itself, because what happened is that there was a PP, which was okay. When the Catalan issue was not hot, they could sort of look polite. Now the Catalan issue is there. You know, Aznar yesterday made the declaration on the throne, okay, no one is going to be tougher than me.
Nobody.
Nobody. I mean, and he is the author of Ciudadanos and Abascal. He has created these monsters.
Yes,
okay? So, there they are. But, you know, these monsters were there all along. You know, these, and in a way, I'm also, but, you know, this anti-Catalan xenophobia, which is now so explicit, was there all along. It, you know, sometimes it goes underwater and, you know, feels that it cannot express now at each other period, and it feels, you know, it can express, and that generates votes. But, you know, the socialists have to realize that democracy comes with some costs. You know, if you call yourself a democrat, you have some obligations. And those obligations have to do with human rights, separation of powers, respect for minorities. You know, there is a whole list of things. It's not enough. Okay, well, Spain is a democracy. Well, the more you say it, the less I believe it. Just do it. So, honestly, I think that we, in a way, you know, I don't think it was very important whether the Catalan parties supported or didn't support the budget. It was a fantastic occasion for Sanchez to call the election and make the point, oh, I don't surrender to Catalans, right? So, but at some point, if Sanchez wants to, you know, become a statesman, he will have to take some steps. I know there is all this talk about the transition, okay? I mean, we have a lot to criticize about the transition, but there were some things that were good, and, you know, just Suárez did take steps. You know, he was bold in a way. He legalized the Communist Party. He accepted the Tarradellas to return. So, I mean, at that point, these things seem impossible, and he did them. So, you know, in politics is precisely the art of doing what looks impossible. And if Sanchez wants to have a positive contribution to this stage, which he might not, I mean, you may have to wait for someone else. But if he wants to contribute in resolving that problem than making it more difficult, he'll have to take some steps that his own party will not approve.
Any more questions, John?
Thank you very much. I wanted to ask, Clara, about your experiences in Scotland since you have ended up in St. Andrews University, a very, very nice place to be. But I wonder, given what Scotland has gone through since their referendum on independence, and in particular what has happened to Scotland via the Brexit process, where their vote is ignored, and not only that, where the SNP government has been continually mistreated and derided by London, in your encounters with people in Scotland, do they talk about the parallels in the Scottish and Catalan experience, and do they offer you any lessons, or do you draw from each other when you look at the future?
I mean, the first lesson is they have great politicians. I mean, I wish we could have people like Nicola or Joan Michel on our side. And you go on the list, and you know, they are just, wow, these guys are so smart, they speak so well, and such clarity of ideas. And, you know, when I look at my colleagues and at myself, okay, we, you know, we're not the same. Okay, so that's the first comparison. And in a way, it goes for the second one. What do they, when they, you know, Scots that feel very strongly about independence, and now I'm talking about the members of the party, for example, the SNP, not the, you know, not the hierarchies, but, you know, the people. You know, I've been invited to some, you know, town hall meeting with, you know, just they have this great admiration of how Catalans have mobilized for independence, and they have this longing, okay, we are not able to do that in Scotland, right? So we have very good politicians, very structured these narratives, but they don't have this, you know, this popular support that does not express only at voting, but, you know, that expressing these very big demonstrations, people having this, in a way, probably what the difference is that if you pick a Catalan and it turns out to be a supporter of independence, this person goes to, you know, goes to demonstrations, wears the ribbon, buys, you know, he's a member of Omnium Manifest, this and that, and, you know, and wants to do more. If you take a Scot that supported independence in the referendum or that would support independence right now, they are, okay, they're more easygoing because, well, they've had the privilege, and that's what I, you know, if I could choose what situation would I prefer, I prefer the Scottish situation because I wouldn't be in prison. okay, I'm not in prison, my colleagues, nobody would be in prison. Anyway, so, you know, it's the Scottish situation is a situation of standard politics, of civilized dialogue. They certainly have to take steps now after the Brexit mess crisis. It's not clear that they are going to be able to move forward because it's delicate, you know, if you have Brexit, okay, I don't want to get into Scottish politics, but, you know, if you have had Brexit, how are you going to convince, you know, people just living right? I mean, there is a border there, right? It's, whatever problems Ireland may have, Scotland has similar issues. So it's not clear that, okay, because they, you know, because we've seen Brexit and it's so terrible, now all Scots are for independence. Oh, shit. I don't think that's such an easy ride, and that's why they are being so prudent, and, you know, they are extremely nuanced. But yeah, I mean, I am a total fan of the politicians for their style and their quality. In a way, Catalan politics has suffered from the same, you know, from the Spanish, the same illness of the Spanish politics because of the system of closed list and the control of parties, you know, the very tight control of parties over who gets into to run for parliament or for this or that. You know, it's a very negative selection. If you want to do a political career in Spain or in Catalonia, you have to do is research well, don't stand up, you know, just be the party, behave, say yes, and that will get you a result in the list. And that generates a terrible selection. So, I mean, this is a fascinating topic, the comparison, and we could go on and on.
Just a very quick question because no time is moving on. Where in your economics and finance hat, if you're talking about like independence within the European framework, I think is not on for Catalonia or Scotland for because none of the other states will wear it. So why not work as say the Corsicans are doing? They're taking control of local institutions under kind of a 20-year plan, bit by bit, and they're now running quite a lot of their own affairs. So with that, how would you go about setting about the fiscal transfer to Madrid, which is a big, big issue for any possible sort of future government of Catalonia?
I don't know the Corsican case.
Well, I'm just saying this idea of gathering competences, taking control of things.
Well, but so this is what Catalans tried to do over decades, from 1980. Until the reform of the Statute. And, okay, for a while, it seemed to work, but, you know, then it, you know, we just hit the wall and there was no more progress and, you know, we started to regress. So that's why the Statute was reformed, trying to, in a way, to, you know, gain leverage so that we could make sure that what we our competences were our competences, and that we had proper financing for our government, but that was blocked. So at this point, I don't think there is any room for this kind of agenda in Catalonia. I want to know more about Corsica, because I think that's a very interesting case, because of course, you know, Corsica is a nation in the most centralistic European country, so whatever strategies they are following, they need to be imaginative.
Would you think that the fiscal transfers, it's more of a political question, really? I was asking you for...
Yeah, fiscal transfers, at the end of the day, you know, you want fiscal transfers and you want political guarantees that those fiscal transfers are going to be maintained. If you get the fiscal transfer, but then, you know, a constitutional court can undo it, or, you know, a majority of the government, of the people, you know, when a new government comes in the Spanish parliament, it has a majority to undo that, you know, so there is no, the problem of the failure of the Spanish autonomic state is the failure of the system of guarantees. You know, federal states are, you know, covenants of mutual agreement with guarantees. You know, there is institutions that oversee, that are above everybody, you know. You have the Supreme Court in the States, you have the Constitutional Tribunal in Germany. We had the Constitutional Tribunal in Spain, but the Constitutional Tribunal stopped acting as a neutral referee. Well, it wasn't properly designed in the Constitution. I mean, there are faults in the Constitution, which were not accidents. They were designed to be so that Spain wouldn't be a federal state. But, you know, for decades, Catalans still dream of moving from the constitution into a federal arrangement, but we couldn't. I don't see that coming back.
Now, I'm conscious Clara has been talking for a good hour and 20 minutes. Can I ask if there are any final questions and we can wrap up?
So imagine that tomorrow Catalonia is independent and you can go back home and you are again appointed as Minister of Education. Would you take it?
Would I take it?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. A lot of ideas about education, yeah.
Because you couldn't make much with the time that you were there.
But with the time, I mean, with the time I was there, all I could do was to make sure that the schools were open October 1st and that schools were also open September 12th or 13th, that the school year starts, so, and, you know, the buildings were ready and all these things. But, that's moving totally different. So, totally different out of course. I mean, I don't think this situation will arise in my, you know, professional life. I'm older than I look, and it's going to take a while for us to be a properly functioning independent country. But yeah, education is probably the most exciting line of politics one can take, and certainly there is a lot to be done to improve our education, which is reasonably good, okay? So it's not be too critical. It's reasonably, it's functional. It has, in terms of standardized results, statistics is okay, but has a lot of room for improvement. And I think it's probably, you know, it's, Catalonia is a very small country. So it's very small, not as small as others. We have a tendency of a consensus. Here I'm being controversial. You know, it's very difficult to think different. And if you don't think different, it's very hard to make improvements. You need to have, you know, healthy innovation. And so, okay, but this is, I think, I'm totally drifting off today's topic.
So I think we'll draw to a close. Clara, thank you very much.
Thank you.